Scripture says in John 16, verse 33, Jesus tells us, he says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. And he says this, he says, you will have suffering in this world. He didn't say you might. He said you will have suffering in this world. But he gives us this promise and this challenge and this encouragement. He says, be courageous. For I have overcome the world. Boy, isn't that awesome? That even in the midst of pain and suffering and grief and turmoil, that we know that our Redeemer, our Savior, has conquered death, has conquered sin. So, church, be courageous, even in the midst, and know that Jesus saves.
Jesus saves, Jesus saves, hear the you, church. Listen to the word of God. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Christ from the dead, to an inheritance, listen to this, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept for you in heaven, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. And we thank you for the great salvation that we have through Christ Jesus, our Savior. Thank you, Father, for keeping us, for the grip that you have upon our life through Christ Jesus. Thank you for the work of your Spirit within our hearts and minds that helps us understand the victory we have through Christ. And thank you, Father, for the precious blood of Jesus that was spilled at Calvary's cross to cover our sin. Thank you for the forgiveness of our sin and the freedom and liberty we have in you. Thank you, Father, for what you are doing in the midst of our struggles and challenges and our suffering. Be glorified. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Want to welcome you to our time of worship. You could be anywhere, but you chose to be here. You came, and I trust that God will do a work in your heart, that He will be all you need today. He is. He is sufficient. Well, if you have a prayer request, a concern on your heart, I would love for you to give me the privilege of walking alongside you, with you during the course of the week in prayer. I will gladly meet with you, but I can't be everywhere. God is. And God will be at work in your life. And I want to pray with you for those matters on your heart. So use the tab of the worship bulletin to make a note. When you have finished, fold that in half, covering your prayer request, because we want to keep them confidential. Only the ministers and I see these. And so when you make your way to your Bible study group after our worship time, leave those prayer requests in that offering plate. Let it be an offering of sacrifice to the Lord. And let's place this matter before the Lord during the course of the week. Thank you for allowing us to do that. There's so many ministry opportunities. Please take note of these in your worship guide. But right now, our choir is going to share and minister to us again. Let's worship our God today. Amen. Amen. From above.
shackles and chains, but I've been freed and forgiven. Oh, yes, I have. I'm not going back. I'll never be the same.
All my hope is in Jesus.
All my hope is in
truth. I hope that your hope, the hope that anchors your soul, I hope that it's in Jesus. I hope that it's not in earthly things, placed in things that will perish away, but that your hope is in Jesus' holy name. You see, when I think about suffering, think about someone who's been through the fire, who endured so much. I can only think of a person in the Bible. His name is Job. And all that Job endured. But the purpose was not to so much, I don't think, to teach Job a lesson, but it was to see the glory of God in the midst of all of it. To see the power of God Almighty. And even in the midst of all that, Job fell to his knees. Well, first he ripped off all his clothes and he shaved his head. And he said, he just surrendered to the Lord. But he said, blessed. Even in the midst of all this, he said, blessed be the name of the Lord. So I'm asking, if you're here this morning, whatever it is you're going through, whatever trial that you may face, can you, even in the midst of it all, say, blessed be the name of the Lord? Horatio Spafford wrote this now famous hymn, right above the waters where the sea had swallowed up his children. These words, when peace like a river attendeth my way, and when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. So I encourage you this morning, whatever it is, wherever you are, because of Jesus Christ and what he's done in your life and mine and for the world, we can say that it is well with our soul. Amen. Let's stand and worship the Lord God Almighty.
Oh,
presence. And he says, I want to help you. I want to heal you. I want to make you whole. So how do I do that? I surrender to the Lord God. I come hurting, broken, overwhelmed by sin that so easily entangles us. We come to the altar and we say, God, I can't do this without you. I can't make it without you. The Holy Spirit works within us, convicts us of our sin. So this morning, whether it's now or later on after the message or whatever it is, I urge you, don't ignore that call. God is trying to do a work in you and through you. So lay it all down. Give it to Jesus. Come to the altar.
Hurting and broken within, overwhelmed by
Church, I invite you to join me in the book of Hebrews, again, chapter 11. And this morning, we want to focus on the third emphasis that I believe you will find in the examples of faith given to us in the 11th chapter. I have shared with you that in Hebrews chapter 11, faith is expressed in three practical ways. The first, faith is expressed through righteous living, okay? And then there was a focus, and the transition zeroes in on those who were obedient in life's journeys. And the things that they had before them, as they followed the Lord's plan and path for their life, they were obedient. And by their obedience, they give example to you and me how we can live in relationship with God, in a right relationship with God, regardless of what our life path may be. Sometimes it's difficult and it's hard. Sometimes we wonder, why me? But our obedience will bring the encouragement, the light, the understanding, the peace of God, the joy of the Lord in that journey. And then this morning, I want us to focus for just a few moments on this practical expression of faith through suffering. And we're going to zero in on Moses. Today, we explore this faith expressed through the sufferings of Moses, okay? And in Hebrews chapter 11, you will find the story of Moses, his example, referenced beginning in verse 23. In verse 23, it starts with regard to his parents and their relationship to the Lord as revealed and expressed through their protection of Moses. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents, because they saw that the child was beautiful, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not be touched. In these verses, I ask you to consider with me three things. Now, as we look at what is given to us here in these verses, I want to remind you that biblical faith views suffering differently than what most people without Christ would view suffering. Biblical faith, a man, a woman, engaged with the Lord in a right relationship with God, will come to understand that through suffering, there are some very specific benefits. One is that suffering is like fire that forges steel. The forging of steel makes the steel tougher. It resists cracks and chipping. Forged steel is a picture of our faith when it is unleashed and focused on Christ. Because in the midst of suffering, it is like the fire that is going to make us tougher, prepare us for a more difficult and challenging work ahead of us. But that's not all. You see, I believe that biblical faith is also like the tilling of soil. Hard, calloused, hardened soil And when suffering is unleashed in our life and we experience those pains and are able to identify with Christ, it builds compassion within us. Jesus understood suffering in this way. Jesus, his life was challenging. It was difficult. He did not have an easy ride to Calvary. Calvary in itself helps us understand how serious the rejection of Christ was. And so I want to remind you of how Jesus understands suffering and how his life, and through his suffering, his life was prepared even more to be compassionate and communicates how to be compassionate and understanding with others who are going through suffering. In Hebrews chapter 2, look with me at verse 18. I'm going to take you to three verses that speak about Jesus here before we look at Moses to help us understand that suffering can be good for a believer. Why should we be immune from what everybody else goes through? And if a faith is not tested, can it be trusted? How do you know that Jesus is sufficient? How do you know that Christ is enough? If you don't go through suffering, if you don't face struggles in your life to the point that you must trust Him and that you are totally dependent upon Him, then you will not know the beauty of God's faithfulness and grace and compassion and sufficiency in the midst of life's hardships. But Jesus understood. Verse 18 of chapter 2 in Hebrews, "For because He Himself has suffered when tempted, He is able to help those who are being tempted." Speaking of Jesus, chapter 4, verse 15, listen to this word about our Savior. "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin." And then again, in chapter 5, verse 8, listen to this verse relating to Jesus and his sufferings. "Although he was a son," speaking of Jesus, "he learned obedience through what he suffered." So don't complain. Don't lose God's blessing when you face hard times. What was some of the suffering that Jesus experienced? Well, he experienced rejection. People slandered him, maligned him. They said things that were lies about him. He was pushed aside. He was rejected. People were offended at his effort to love and help and minister and care for them. They rejected his instruction and direction. Jesus understood temptation. He was tempted by Satan after a 40-day fast. He had been fasting for 40 days in the wilderness, and then Satan approached him three times, offered him the good life in time to compromise, or for the compromise of God's blessing in eternity. And Jesus understood the ploy of Satan. And he, with three verses of scripture from the book of Deuteronomy, laid a whipping on Satan and sent him with his tail tucked and a tear in his eye because he failed. And you too can be victorious through temptation. You need not yield. You're not a victim. Life is what we choose in relationship to God. Well, we could speak more about the sufferings of our Christ, our Lord. But I want us to see if we can relate to Moses' suffering, the things he went through. In verse 24 through 26, You're going to see that Moses' faith is expressed through his choice, to suffer with God's people. Look at verse 24 of Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. Moses was able to endure the challenge of choice because he kept his focus on his God. When you and I are faced with choices, if we do not make our choice deliberately to be obedient and compliant with the purpose and heart and instruction of God, we bring disaster to ourselves and people around us. There are consequences to every choice you make, good or bad. Every choice has its consequence. You are free to choose whatever you want in that moment. You're free to choose, but you are not free to choose the consequence. Every choice will bring its consequence to fruition in your life, in my life. Moses understood that he had a choice to make. Would he remain identified with Pharaoh and his daughter? Would he identify and benefit from the pleasures and the bounty and all the good things that the Pharaoh and the wealth of Egypt could afford him? Would he choose the easy life, or would he choose a very hard, difficult life where he would face hunger and thirst, ridicule, where people would murmur behind his back, plot against him, wish he was dead, hate him, blame him for everything that goes wrong? With whom would he identify? Who would you choose to identify with? Moses chose to identify with the people of God and the God of that people. And there was community with that identity. Who you choose as your friends and where you choose to express your passion and worship determines the consequences that will come in your life. Sooner or later, your choice brings to bear upon your life the consequences associated with that choice. And Moses chose to identify with the Lord God and his people. Moses didn't understand all that was going to take place, but that's where he landed. Here's a little principle that is communicated here. It is the principle of self-denial. Self-denial. There's another principle communicated here. Delayed gratification. Moses discerned, he had come to understand that if he denied himself certain privileges that the world offered, he would benefit from the privileges that God would give and grant and bring to fruition in his life, choosing to identify with God rather than the world. Moses also understood that God would meet his needs, and that the desire of his heart would be gratified in time, not in the moment, not in the immediate present, if he would keep his focus on the promises of God. The scripture, it's interesting how verse 26 says, "For he was looking to the reward." It gives this explanation of why he was able to endure, to make the wise choice, the right choice, to endure all that he would face. How did he find strength? Where did this strength come from? He kept his focus on the Lord. The scripture says he was looking to the reward. You could pencil in there the reward of God. Man will offer you stuff right now. God saves his best for last. Amen? I'll put it, said it a little different. Satan will offer you his best right now, but it only gets worse. God offers you his worst right now, but it only gets better. Now you ponder that. Moses is an example of one who went through all kinds of suffering because he chose to identify with God and with the people of God. But there's a second life lesson here in verse 27. Verse 27, Moses' faith is expressed through facing the wrath of Pharaoh. Look at verse 27. The scripture says, "By faith he left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible." Was Moses fearful of the king? I want to clear some things up here. I want you to understand that Moses was a real man, okay? With real life challenges, he stuttered. When God initiated his call to Moses and told him to go to Pharaoh, Moses said, "I can't. I can't talk. I'm a man of stuttering lips." He had excuses. And I love Moses' strategy because he needed a partner. Moses said, when God called, he said, "Here am I. Send Aaron." Everybody needs an Aaron. Somebody that will walk beside you, go with you. But who was the spokesman? It was Moses. Moses was the man. And yes, Moses was a real man. And he had anxiety, nervous moments. His palms would sweat. He would stutter even worse when he was put on the spot, no doubt. Anxiety was real. Fear is a real emotion. But he feared God more. And when you place your fear, your awe in the right place, then what Satan throws at you begins to pale. Keep your focus on God. Who is the Lord God? Who is this one calling me from the burning bush? Who is this one that is commissioning me? It is the Lord God. Look at what he has done. Look at, and he began to reflect back on all that he had been taught. And Moses, even though he was uncomfortable and even had a little nervous shaking, trembling, he stood, he spoke, he stood, he went, he stood because of God. He put his faith in the Lord, and the Lord proved to be sufficient. The Lord gave him strength for the moment. God's grace was sufficient, and it will be for you. So don't be afraid of the Pharaohs in your life. Don't be afraid of the Red Seas in your life. Don't be afraid of the hunger and the thirst and all the other stuff that you go through. Trust God. So here we find Moses, a man who was very acquainted with suffering, expressed his faith through a deliberate choice to be with God's people. He expressed his faith through facing the wrath of Pharaoh, knowing that the hand of God was great and sufficient to protect and provide and to guide him, regardless of what Pharaoh attempted. And so Moses stood. But there's a third expression here. Look at verse 28. In verse 28, the scripture tells us, by faith, Moses kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not touch them. The destroyer would not touch them. That is, the death angel would be stayed from their camp, from their house. And on that fateful eve, you can read it in Exodus chapter 12, the Passover. Instructions were given. Preparations were made according to God's instruction. And the Lord, who had stirred and instructed Moses, had given to Moses the opportunity, the instruction of how to protect his people from death. And it was through the blood of the Lamb. The blood of the Lamb. The Lamb was sacrificed, and Moses took a branch of hyssop, a very bitter herb, took a branch of hyssop, and he would dip it in the basin of blood, and he sprinkled the doorpost and the lintel of every house of the Hebrews. And as that blood was covering the entrance to those houses, the people were instructed, stay inside your house. Do not go outside the house. The only shield, the only protection we have is the blood of the Lamb. And the death angel passed through Egypt that night. The firstborn of all the families of the Egyptians and everyone else died. And the firstborn of all the livestock, the cattle, firstborn of everything died that night. And there was a great mourning. There was a great cry heard throughout the land of Egypt, but not among the Hebrews. Do you know why? Because of the blood of the Lamb. You see, in this very difficult, challenging life situation, what we see in Moses is a faith expressed through preparing for the death angel with the blood of the Lamb. And friend, if suffering does anything for you and me, it ought to remind us to make preparation, because there is a door through which every one of us will walk, called death. And you will walk through that door into an eternity. And you will either be with the Lord God, or you will be separated from the Lord God and spend eternity in a place prepared for the devil and the fallen angels. A place God never intended a man go. And someone has said, a loving God would never send a person to a place like hell. And I agree. God has given the blood of the Lamb to cover your sin. You choose to go to that place. God has chosen to save you and provide a way of escape. Friend, if we see anything in Moses, I say we see faith that through his choice to identify with God's people, he brought deliverance to God's people, and God brought blessing to his life. A man whose faith was expressed through facing the wrath of Pharaoh, trusting God to deliver him and protect him and provide every need he would have in the face of such adversity, intimidation, and threat. And we see a man who expressed his faith in a very practical way. He made preparation for death, dealing with death appropriately. That's the kind of faith you and I need. You and I need a faith in the Lord God who gave his son Jesus Christ to pay our sin debt. He didn't only die to secure our salvation. He gave his life to show us the way to God himself. That even in death, God has the power to raise his children to life again. Do you want that power in your life? There's only one place it is found, and it is the person of Jesus Christ. Come to Jesus and live. Amen? Brothers, sisters, put your faith in Jesus. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word, and thank you for the opportunity you give us in this moment to experience your grace, your forgiveness, your salvation. Lord, I pray that in a moment when we stand together to worship you through life commitment, that you would stir our hearts and help us to trust you with our soul, to embrace Jesus as Savior, to turn to Christ and live in the forgiveness and the healing from our sin. Lord, I pray for those who realize today that, like Moses, they need to identify, they need to connect, not only with you, but with your people. And they need to serve alongside your people, a people who are broken, but a people who are focused upon you and focused to take the gospel to the world. Lord, I pray for those who need to connect with your church through membership. I pray, Lord, for those who need to follow you in simple obedience, an obedience that begins with baptism. Lord, you have called us to so identify with you through baptism, through connection with your body. Father, you've called us to an altar where every day we can find the forgiveness we need for the sin that is destroying our lives. And so, Father, for those who are here today, who are going through life's struggles and battles, I pray that you would give them courage to lift their eyes to you. Lord, here we are. Here we are, Father, needing you. Would you accept us as we are and change us that we might be like you? Lord, give us courage to come to you, to stand with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together this morning. In this time of worship, this time of worship is designed for you to act upon what God has been stirring in your heart. It is a time for you and me to do what God is calling us to do. What is God calling you to do? Is it to embrace Jesus as Savior? Is it to connect with his body, the church? Is it to follow in obedience through baptism? That is the first step of obedience for a believer. I ask you this morning, come to Jesus. It doesn't matter what lays ahead for you. What matters is who you face it with. Face the future with our Savior, Jesus. Come today. Do it now. moments, we're going to make our way to our Bible study groups. If you're one of our guests, I really want to encourage you to venture into one of our groups. Just be intentional. You may not have come prepared today, but if the Lord is impressing upon your heart to do it today, I would encourage you, check the people of God out. I think you will find warmth, encouragement, support. You will find integrity. You will find a commitment to the Word of God and a desire to make a difference in people's lives. That's what you will find. I want to encourage you, plug into one of our small groups. I'm going to be right outside the doors over here. And if you're one of our first-time guests, would you give me just a moment to say thank you for worshiping with us? And I will not delay you from wherever you may be going next, but I just want to say thank you. I would be most honored if you would give me just a few moments, okay?